Hello everyone and welcome to another video of RunGB. Today we are going to see something a little bit different from my previous videos. Until now I have been uploading games mostly and I think it's time to start uploading other stuff as well. Of course, don't worry, I'm going to still upload gameplay of games I like to play. Most prominently, of course, Naval Action. But in the meantime, and after coming back from a 2-week vacation, I've been out and, well, having a good time, I'm going to put up a video which is going to be different. It's going to be based on history. Now, one of the things I know a lot about is about World War II history. And after watching some videos in YouTube, I've decided to make some videos about, well, World War II stuff. Usually dealing with myths that everyone tends to believe, and they are not actually as true as people might believe. And I think a good point to start is, well, with planes, and more exactly with one plane. The Republic P-47 Thunderbolt. Now, why this plane? Well, in general, because I think it's a very mistook and misunderstood plane. A lot of people still are discussing and debating today about whether it was a fighter or not. I'm not making this up. Actually, in one of the commentaries of my videos, this debate is currently raging from people who say that this was a fighter and people who say it was a fighter bomber and a failed fighter. The thing is that a lot of people think that is the case, that the P-47 was only a fighter bomber. And I want to, well, give a little historical perspective on the P-47, and then I will speak a little bit about the P-47 myths and whether they are true or not. So, well, without further ado, let's speak about a little bit about the P-47. First, we are going to speak about the history of the plane, how it was developed, and why the P-47 actually, well, got to exist. The P-47 was a model built by an aircraft manufacturing company called Republic. However, Republic was previously known as Seversky, and it was known as Seversky because, well, of the founder. The founder was a former Russian World War I ace called Alexander Seversky. Alexander Seversky won the title of being an ace in World War I by shooting down at least 13 German fighters. Actually, during the war, he actually lost a leg as well. By the time the Communist Revolution happened in Russia, he was in the United States as a military attaché, and he decided not to come back to the, motherland, because at the time, there were a lot of reports about Soviet officers being executed by the Bolsheviks. So, well, he applied for an American citizenship, and he was awarded it. So, after being awarded his nationality, his new American citizenship, Seversky moved on to be associated with General Billy Mitchell. He was actually his personal assistant for something like 8-9 years, something like that. Afterwards, he moved on and he created his own aircraft building company. However, the project failed because of the 1929 stock market crash. Still, shortly thereafter, in 1931, he started yet another project with a new firm, which was called Seversky Aircraft Corporation. And he was able to bring along two expatriates, two former Russian air designers. One of them was called Michael Gregor, and the other one, and this name probably will sound very familiar to you, Alexander Katpaly. Now, of course, we are speaking that the P-47 has actually a lot to do with Russians. And yes, that's actually the point. The first big scale project of the new company, the Seversky Aero Corporation, was the P-35. A monoplane with a retractable landing gear, not very evolved, but, well, it was kind of a new thing in an era where most of the things related with aviation was moving very forward. The 30s was a decade where fighters moved on from being biplanes with a couple of machine guns to being monoplanes with cannons and lots of machine guns. And while not being as evolved as maybe Curtiss P-36 or a BF-109 or a Spitfire, still this was a monoplane metal fighter with retractable landing gear, which was pretty remarkable for its day. However, the plane on itself wasn't really that remarkable. I mean, the performance wasn't that great, but still was, well, good enough to win them a little bit of reputation as aircraft builders. So at this stage was when the 1939 air competition held by the United States Air Force came up. Actually, the United States Air Force at the time was called United States Army Air Corps, but to simplify things, I will call it the Air Force. So again, we are in 1939, and the US Air Force, well, they opened a competition for a new fighter for, well, for their use. Now, this competition saw some very famous contenders. Most of them you will know. One of them was the P-39, the Era Cobra, was designed for this competition. The P-38 was designed for this competition. And the P-40 was actually designed for this competition. The winner of the contract was the P-40. The other contenders, well, for several reasons, couldn't really compete. The P-39 had a lot of trouble. It was designed with a turbocharger. Then it was removed, the turbocharger was no longer in the Era Cobra, where we all know more or less how the story went. And the P-38 had some teething troubles later on, became, of course, very successful plane, and the famous Lightning. But what a lot of people don't remember is that in that competition, Seversky was also present. And he presented a prototype of, well, an evolution, let's call it, of the P-35. The Seversky's contender was called AP-4. The AP-4 was a plane clearly designed from the base of the P-35, but with a turbocharger, one that really took a lot of space to take and wake. The plane, however, had a lot of potential, and the US Air Force wasn't blind to that fact. So even while the P-40 actually won the contract, Seversky was allowed to continue improvements on the project to see, well, whether the evolution of the plane would lead somewhere or not. Actually, the same was true with the Era Cobra and the Lightning. All of those planes actually entered service at one point or another. Of course, that didn't mean that all of them were successful. The most successful of them all was the P-38, but the AP-4 was also contemplated for that, so it was given a code, which was P-43, and was allowed to move on. At that time, however, Seversky was having some really serious trouble, financial trouble. Seversky himself was removed from the CEO position and replaced it with a new CEO, and the company itself changed its name from Seversky to Republic. So the new Republic, P-43, moved on to enter service, actually, and it's so used in the AVG, the famous Flying Tigers, was one of the plane models which was available in Southeast Asia by the time the Japanese declared war in the United States. Now, of course, everyone somehow connects the Flying Tigers with the P-40, because of course the P-40 was the most used plane of that force. But they also used the P-43, and actually they liked it a lot, and they actually liked it more than the P-40. Why? Well, because the P-40 didn't have a turbocharger, and at high altitude it wasn't really good. The P-43 had a turbocharger, and at high altitude it was unchallenged by any Japanese plane. The problem, of course, is that there were very few around, and they were eventually phased out because of lack of spare parts. The P-40 was still in ample supply, so the AVG settled on the P-40 as its main plane, and the P-43, well, disappeared from the pages of history without being actually that known, even while it was a very good fighter, but it wasn't simply there in big enough numbers. However, at that point, of course, having such a good base to base a fighter on, Republic moved on, and they developed what they called the P-44, or actually the XP-44, because it never went beyond anything experimental. The XP-44 was a development of the, obviously, P-43, but with a bigger engine, the R2800, which was a Pratt & Whitney's new power plant, which of course we all know by now, but back then was just entering service. This was a very big plant, very heavy, but offered a massive amount of power. We are speaking about powers on the region more or less of 2,000 horsepower in an age where the DB601 was offering 1,200, or the Spitfires and Merlin was around 1,100 horsepower. So you can see it was very powerful. So they created a fighter based on that engine, which was intended to be a short range, very fast climbing, very powerful interceptor, which was the XP-44. However, at that stage, the United States Air Force saw no interest in having a short range fighter. They wanted something with long range, so they canceled the project. They weren't interested into that. The prototypes of the P-44 were actually really, really, really promising, but the problem was that simply there was no interest in the plane. However, while they were canceling that plane, the US Air Force told Republic to work on something even bigger, with bigger range, and heavier as well. And here is where the actual story of the P-47 begins. Now, the P-47 began with a series of very, very demanding petitions from the Air Force. The Air Force, when they cancelled the P-44, well, they made the Republic know that the fighter they wanted would have to accomplish 5 different points. The first one was that the aircraft had to have a speed of 400 miles per hour at 25,000 feet. The second, that it needed at least 650 calls, and that if they could provide for 8, that would be even better. The third one was that armor was demanded for the pilot, at least in the back seat. The fourth was that self-sealing tanks were demanded as well. The XP-44 and the P-43 have no self-sealing tanks, and those were one of the reasons why the models were disliked. And finally, they demanded a fuel capacity of 315 gallons. Of course, when tasked with these demands, Kurt Bailey, which was the head designer for Republic at that time, well, he soon realized that the P-44 couldn't compete with that. And there was no way that the way it was designed, it would be able to achieve all those requirements. So what he did was to take the P-44 as a base and stretch it, make it bigger, change the wing shape, and in general, introducing so many new features that the model was to be renamed as something totally new. Actually, the prototype of the P-47 was 12,500 pounds heavy, which was actually well above the weight that the Air Force was demanding. But the Air Force made Republic known that, well, they didn't really care about the weight. What they really cared about was about the 5 things they had been told. So, yeah, well, the prototype actually accomplished all that. Of course, it was not without faults. There were a lot of modifications needed before the P-47 entered production. The prototype of the model flew in May 1941. In November 1941, a series of the P-47 was ordered as the YP-47. Of course, shortly thereafter, Japan declared war. Well, actually, US declared war on Japan after Pearl Harbor. And, the project was really accelerated. Soon enough, the P-47B was into full production and in service with the US Air Corps. Of course, that was at early 1942, the plague was still new, lots of teething troubles had to be solved, and, well, pilots had to be converted with for the new model, which, weighing 6.5 tons and going up with each modification, required very different tactics from standard fighters of the time. The first fighter group to change over to the P-47 is actually a legendary one. I guess everyone in who likes World War II and likes aviation knows about them. I'm speaking, of course, of the 56th fighter group, which is legendary. Let's say that in enough time it was the fighter group with most aces in the whole United States Air Force, including people like Robert Johnson, which we're going to talk about a little bit about later on. After more or less 1 year of, getting used to the new plane, the very different characteristics it had compared with the contemporaneous fighters, the unit was ready to move across to Europe and move on to Great Britain. The 56th Air Group, fighter group, actually moved on to England in January 1943. And roughly at that time, the new model of the P-47 came online, the P-47C. Now, the changes were mostly related with the engine power, some minor details. They were very similar, but it had more power, and as a result, was faster, better climber, overall, a better plane. Now, of course, now in Britain, we have a problem. And the problem is that the 56th Air Group have made the whole transition to the new model. They have had 1 full year to become accustomed to the new plane, the new fighter, and they had grown very, very, very confident into it. But the United States pilots already in England, which had formerly flown with the Eagle Squadron, with the Royal Air Force, well, they were used to the Spitfires, and of course they couldn't see how that big lumbering massive thing, which weighed around 7 tons by that stage, with a very powerful engine, but that no way could compensate for weighing twice as much as a Spitfire, well, how that massive big brick could compete with their Spitfires. It didn't work very well, really, for them, because they had no confidence in the airplane. And the former Eagle Squadron was actually reformed as the 4th Fighter Group, and their first mission over Europe didn't help at all, because it was the first mission, it was the first operational use of the P-47. A lot of things were wrong. The radios didn't work, and there were a lot of minor teething details, like maybe some planes reported smoke coming into the cockpit, guys having jamming problems, a lot of very minor things that had a lot more to do with the fact that they only had 3 months to do the changeover from the Spitfire to the P-47. But overall, well, those pilots didn't really like the plane beforehand, and that mission really didn't help at all to build the confidence. And it was at this point where, well, there's this little story, which a lot of people say it wasn't that massive, but I personally think it made a huge, huge difference. At this point, where the former Eagle Squadron, now 4th Fighter Group pilots, were reluctant to fly that plane again, and they were actually claiming for a Spitfire, that's how it was. The 4th Fighter Group did a formal request to transition back to the Spitfire 9. Well, at that point, Robert Johnson, which was by then a very skilled pilot in the Thunderbolt and was going to move on to be one of the highest scoring aces of World War II in the United States Air Force, stated fight with a Spitfire 9 in his P-47C. Now, of course, whoever has seen my War Thunder videos and whoever knows about planes a little bit knows that boom and zoom absolutely destroys light planes, and that was exactly the instance. Those pilots who had went into combat with the Spitfire, they were in love with the turning ability of the Spitfire, the slow speed handling of the plane, the very fast climb rate of the model, and they couldn't see how a slow climbing brick of a plane that weighed 7 tons and really couldn't turn worth a shit, because it was like that, the P-47 couldn't turn, was better than their Spitfires. What actually happened was that in that staged fight, Bob Johnson did pure boom assume. As soon as the fight was started, he went into a power dive, left the Spitfire behind, then he moved on to a zoom climb, which moved the Spitfire even farther back, then did a couple of high-speed barrel rolls, which the Spitfire couldn't follow because the Spitfire couldn't roll at high speed, and ended up in behind of the Spitfire. They did several goes, and the B-47 always came on top. Since then, the 4th Fighter Group's pilots never asked for a Spitfire ever again. Of course, by this stage, the B-47 was actually already in combat over Europe. There were 3 groups in England at the time, the 4th Fighter Group, the former Eagle Squadron, the 56th Fighter Group, and the 78th Fighter Group. Now, the B-47 actually proved to be a massive, massive, massive improvement over everything the Allies had over the Channel at that point. They came at a very high altitude, taking advantage of the fact that they had the turbochargers, and at high speed, at high altitudes and high speeds, they were unbeatable. There was a problem, however, and that was that those fighter squadrons were supposed to escort bombers into Germany, and they simply didn't have the range. Now, that was a problem that was going to bite at the rear end of the USSR Air Force during all 1943. We all know that the 8 Air Force bombers were forced to go over Germany without an escort because the P-47 didn't have the range. Now, of course, there was a problem back then because the P-47 didn't have any other means of carrying fuel than the internal capacity. Of course, they had a very big capacity of 315 gallons, but they didn't have they also did have a very thirsty engine. The R2800, the Pratt & Whitney, was really thirsty. I mean, it was a huge engine, it was a 19-cylinder. And, of course, that meant a very short range. Of course, it was partially solved by introducing a ventral rack, which could take an external drop tank. But even with that, the P-47s couldn't go farther than the Belgian frontier with Germany. So, again, the B-17s were forced to move into Germany unescorted. And that wasn't going to change until 1944. Now, during 1943 and moving into 1944, and there was a new model of the Thunderbolt, the B-47D5. Now, at this stage, actually, the model moves on in blocks. The D5, the D10, the D15, the D20, the D25, D28. Each one model carried very minor adjustments from the previous version. I'm not going to go through all them all because we don't have the time. But let's say that in overall terms, and the move to the D version of the P-47 introduced a lot of new stuff, like a more powerful version of the Pratt & Whitney and paddle-bladed propellers, which were much better at using the high power of the engine at very high altitudes. It was with the P-47D as well, of course, where the bubble top canopy was introduced. With, I think it was from the D-25 series onwards, the fuselage was good back and good down, so a bubble top canopy could be introduced and, all around view could be much, much, much improved. And obviously, this is the kind of iconic shape of the P-47. But actually, it was a very late addition to this. This happened around the summer of 1944. Most of the fights of the P-47 before that happened with the standard canopy. But yeah, All of us mostly remember the P-47 in this configuration, and this is what happened. Now, the P-47 had made a reputation by this stage of being absolutely a nightmare for German fighters to fight, especially at very high altitudes, because the P-47 had, a turbocharger, was excellent diving and climbing back in some climbs, and simply had the maneuverability at high altitudes because it had the engine power to pull the plane that German planes didn't have. It was at this stage, late 1943, early 1944, that the Luftwaffe was actually putting the hardest opposition to the 8th Air Force. Further models of the P-47 were improving again. Mostly they were improving the power of the engine and propeller setups, and finally the big change to the teardrop cockpit, the bubble cockpit. And in this shape, well, the P-47 is going to be recognizable until the war's end, because later on, well, there were more versions. There was the M version, which was a P-47D with the P-47N engine, which had no less than 2800 horsepower, which was absolutely a monstrosity, and very, very, very high performing plane. But this stage, however, this plane was only issued to the 56th Fighter Group because of reasons we are about to see. The final version of the P-47 was the P-47N, which was designed specifically for the Pacific, and ideally to cope with the hypothetical range problems of the P-47, which were also solved, as we will see. The P-47N was used to escort B-29s from Okinawa to Japan in the later stages of the war. Now, as for the operational record of the P-47, is absolutely outstanding. I mean, the fighter was actually the one that broke the Luftwaffe's back. Again, let's remember that this fighter was the one that was fighting the Germans in 1943, 1944, before the P-51 was even over Europe, and at a point where the Germans were presenting an organized resistance against the American bombing. Of course, the problem was the range, but that was progressively helped by introducing underwing pylons for further bomb and drop tanks, especially drop tanks. With drop tanks, the P-47 had a hugely extended range that almost actually reached Berlin. So, at the time when the P-51 came along, the P-51B, well, yet the P-47 was actually starting to have the range to score the bombers deep into Germany. And the first missions of the P-51 actually were like that, because the P-51 was introduced in very small numbers at the beginning. And the first big raid that arguably demonstrated that the Mustang was going to win the war over Europe for the United States Air Force, which was the Berlin bombings of March 1944, it had P-51s only over Berlin, because on the way in and on the way out, they were escorted by Thunderbolts. Now, the numbers and sales are revealing. On that day, which was the 6th of March 1944, there were a total of 86 P-38s, which also worked on the way in to escort the bombers and on the way out. P-47s, which were along the way most of the trip inside Germany, and P-51s, which escorted the bombers over Berlin proper. The numbers, again, 86 P-38s, 615 P-47s, and 100 P-51Bs. Now, the kill loss, well, at least the claims, were 3 for the P-38s, 36 for the P-47s, of which 11 were from 56 fighter groups, and the P-51 claimed 43 planes. Actual losses of the Luftwaffe weren't actually that high, but, well, those are the claims. The 8th Air Force, the Bomber Force, actually lost 69 bombers, which is the highest loss of B-17s and B-24s in a single day in the whole of World War II. It was a very rough day, and it goes on to prove how resistant the Luftwaffe was being at the moment. Shortly after that strike, well, a big operation was called, which was codenamed, well, not, the codename actually is worthless, because you are going to remember it mostly because of how it's commonly called, which is the Big Week bombings. The Big Week bombings explicitly targeted Luftwaffe main objectives to bring the Luftwaffe up to fight. A changeover of direction in the 8th Air Force have happened, and well, a very, very famous man was now in command of the bomber offensive of the Americans. The man was no other than Jimmy Doolittle, and well, he changed the whole tactics of the 8th Air Force in what regards to escorts. Up to then, the escorts were defensively attached to the bombers. and they were to play only a defensive role to protect them. From then on, he gave the fighters a free hand. It's where fighter runs started happening in front of the bomber forces to attack the Luftwaffe fighters before they actually could intercept. In general, the whole effort was a lot more aggressive, and his first big operation was the Big Week bombing. Doolittle said that no bomber offensive would be successful until the Luftwaffe had been reduced to an unbattle-worthy fighter force or combat force. So he specifically designed this series of raids to not only target the German air industry, but also to bring the Luftwaffe up to a fight, engage them and kill them both in the sky and in the production lines. And it was very successful. Actually, the Big Week bombings marked the end of the Luftwaffe, or the Jagdwaffe, in fact, the fighter force of the Luftwaffe, as a cohesive unit for defensive purposes. Before that, well, efforts like the one over Berlin happened with a very coordinated German defense. After the Big Week bombings, of course, there still was a lot of defense by the Luftwaffe, but it was never as strong or powerful as before. This was in part due to the fact that a lot of German aces were killed during the Big Week, due to the fact that a lot of planes were shot down, and due to the fact that Germany's fuel situation was worsening as the war went on. But during the Big Week and before, the P-47 was the main fighter of the 8th Air Force. I mean, it was the main escort fighter. We have seen that over Berlin there were 6 times more P-47s than P-51s. So obviously the plane was escorting the bombers in a fighter role. What happened after the Big Week bombings and, huge apocalypse on the Luftwaffe was that, well, Overlord was around the corner, the Normandy bomb disembarkments. So the 8th Air Force switched targets for a while. They stopped the strategic bombing campaign over Germany to concentrate on more tactical and operational targets over France to assist with the invasion. And this is where the P-47 started switching to a different role. Now, we have seen that during the evolving phase of the P-47D, the plane has received a couple of underwing racks that it didn't have previously. Those racks were intended to carry two very big drop tanks to increase the available fuel so the P-47 could escort bombers deeper into Germany. However, during the preparations for the Normandy invasion, well, those wing drop tanks were ditched and were replaced with a couple of bombs. The P-47 also could load up to 6 rockets in fixed bazooka tubes under the wing. So, and also in overload situations, it could load a 500-pound bomb under the belly. Wasn't common, but could be used. So, all in all, we had a fighter that could bomb up to 2,000-pound bombs and 6 rockets, over 850 cals. On top of that, we are speaking about a hugely strong fighter with almost 8 tons, obviously a very tough airframe and a huge engine, radial engine, that was able to take a lot of punishment and keep on going. Meanwhile, planes as the P-51 or the P-38, they have liquid-cooled engines with radiators that a single rifle caliber bullet could destroy. And, well, if you lose your engine in the P-51, you're going down. So, obviously, in a role where a lot of flak is expected, a lot of AA, and even soldiers from the ground shooting at you, the P-47 proved to be a lot more sturdier than the P-51. So after Overlord happened, the 8th Air Force switched back to bombing over Germany. However, at this point, well, the P-51 Mustang production had been accelerated. The plane was coming into big numbers onto England, and obviously, well, if you wanted an escort, you wanted range, and then the B-51 was better than that and the Thunderbolt. So the whole 8 Air Force fighter squadrons, but for one, changed it over the B-51. The one that stood with the P-47 was the 56th fighter group, which kept their Thunderbolts until the war's end. They refused to change over the Mustang. What happened to the Thunderbolt then? Well, it moved on to the other Air Force, the 9th Air Force, the Tactical Air Force. Those forces were, well, allotted with roles of escorting medium bombers over France and on doing fighter bomber attacks on their own. And of course, again, the P-47 was the preferred plane to do that because it was a lot tougher than the P-51 and could load more stuff than the P-51 did. So, this is more or less an overview about the P-47 history. There are a lot of stuff that I didn't mention. Of course, I haven't made a big analysis of why the P-47 was that big of that great of a fighter. Well, if you want to see that, well, you can take a look at any of my P-47 videos of War Thunder, because I explain it all there. It was a very heavy fighter which excelled at high-speed boom and zoom tactics, which ruled the day in air combat in World War II. The better the boom and zoomer, the better plane you had, and the P-47 was the best of them all. Now, time for discussing the myths. Myth number one. The P-47 was a failed fighter and was switched to fighter bomber because it wasn't a good fighter. Well, I think we have pretty much shot that one down already, isn't it? I mean, for most of its combat sorties, the P-47 was actually flown as a fighter, not as a fighter bomber. Yeah, it was a great fighter bomber. It was an amazing fighter bomber because it was really, really tough. It could take a beating. It was a fighter bomber, so obviously it could defend itself if intercepted. And it could load a lot of offensive weaponry to kill enemies. Bombs, rockets, the 50 guns, etc. So obviously it was a very good fighter bomber, but the fact that it was put into the fighter bomber role doesn't mean it wasn't a good fighter. It just meant that there was another fighter which was a better escort. And let's face it, the Americans needed good escorts back then. They didn't need just good fighters. They needed long range as well, and the P-51 had the P-47 beaten at that one parameter. The Mustang had a much longer range, even with drop tanks. That one, it actually got beaten, and that was the only reason why the P-47 was dedicated to fighter bomber roles. Not because the fighter was a fail as a fighter. The P-47 was actually a splendid fighter and was a fighter that broke the Luftwaffe's back. Not the B-51. The B-51 went, it actually was the most common fighter of the 8 Air Force. The Luftwaffe was already beaten, a spent force. Yeah, it was actually still fighting, but it was fighting a desperate fight. The last coordinated defenses of the Germans happened in April of 1944 with the big weak bombings. Afterwards, the Luftwaffe was a shadow of what it once was. And the plane that was there to achieve that wasn't the B-51, was the P-47. Second myth, the P-47 was a hugely flying armored tank because it could stand so much damage. Well, this one is false as well. This actually is a big pile of steamy horse shit. Now, I can give you specific details and even illustrations about exactly how much armor the P-47 had. The P-47 had an armor plate behind the pilot, which was enough to deflect a rifle bullet or a 7.92mm machine gun bullet, but nothing else. That was all the armor it carried. The back plate was, of course, well, needed mostly because of a psychological thing, because the pilots saw the armor plate back there and they felt much more secure. And while the actual protection offered by it wasn't that big, again, it was barely enough to stop a light machine gun bullet. It couldn't stop a heavy machine gun bullet, and a cannon round would smash it into the pilot's back. So that was all the armor the B-47 carried. There was none. No rails, no more armor. The B-47 had no armor. In general, when you hear stories about armored planes in World War II, you can deduce that whoever is talking doesn't have a clue. Unless they are speaking about two particular planes, the IL-2, the Sturmovik, and the Hensel 129, the German twin-engine Sturmovik concept. Those were dedicated ground attack planes with big chunks of armor, and the IL-2 actually had a bathtub of armor protecting the pilot, and in some cases the gunner. But other than that, even those weren't that much more armor than that. I mean, they had armor to protect the cockpit, but the wings weren't armored, the backside of the fuselage wasn't armored. So, yeah, armor in World War II planes didn't make sense. And this is also true about the bombers. I mean, the B-29 had no armor, the B-17 had no armor. When you are designing a bomber, you are designing it to carry a lot of thousands of bombs over enemy territory, not to carry a lot of thousands of tons of armor, which is going to do nothing. The planes that were very hard to shoot down during World War II weren't hard to shoot down because of their armor, unless, again, it was the IL-2 or the Hensel 129. The reason why the P-47 or the B-17 were so hard to shoot down is because they were stupidly over-engineered. I mean, the P-47 was the heaviest, by far, single-engine fighters of the war. 7 tons of structure and engine and toughness flying around. They were stupidly tough. Same with the B-17. It was really rough, very, very sturdy. They were really good at taking damage, that's all. They were very stoutly built, they were very well built, they had engines that stood very well the damage they might be subjected to. I mean, there are stories of P-47s coming back to base with 2 cylinders blown away. I mean, if you think about this, it's ludicrous to think that an engine that has had 2 engines blown up is going to be able to run until you come back to base. Well, those engines actually did so. Of course, the problem was that most engines didn't do that. And most fighters, when subjected to that kind of damage, would go down. The P-47 didn't. So, was the P-47 very hard to bring down? Absolutely, it was tough as nails. Was it because it was very well armored? Nonsense. No, no, it had no armor. Next. Myth number 3. The P-47 was unmaneuverable, was a brick, was impossible to fight with because it was so heavy. In general, it was simply not nimble enough to be a fighter. Well, I think we have tackled that enough in the previous parts of the video too. Yes, there is some truth in that the fact that the P-47 didn't actually turn very well at slow speeds. However, that would be important if the World War II air combat style would involve turning fights at slow speed. However, it wasn't the case. World War II fights were won by high-speed maneuvering and boom and zooming planes. Actually, not even that. It's an estimate that maybe 80% of the fighter pilots of World War II were killed before even they knew they were under attack. Again, that means that the faster you are to catch up with an unaware enemy, the better. And if you can dive on him from above without him looking at you, you are going to kill him faster as well, because if you are in the dive, you are much faster, you are going to come in, rip the kill and get out before the other guy even knew you were there. In that sense, the P-47 was fantastic. The P-47 couldn't turn worth a damn at slow speeds, but if you are moving at 700 km per hour, you don't care about how you maneuver at slow speed. You care about how you maneuver at high speeds. And at high speeds, the P-47 was excellent. It had very well harmonized controls, light enough, it wasn't a tiresome plane to fight. It had a very ample cockpit, so the pilot had a lot of room to move and to exert force on the stick. It was a dream to fight at high speeds, and that's what mattered. Again, you only care about not being able to turn at slow speeds if you actually allow yourself to go at slow speeds. American combat style and combat tactics didn't call for slow speed combat. It called for pure boom and zoom. And there was no better boom and zoomer in World War II than the P-47 Thunderbolt. So, yeah, whoever says that P-47 wasn't a good fighter because it was not maneuverable enough, he has absolutely no clue what he's talking about. Of course, we can speak a lot more about the P-47. We can bring stats. But in my opinion, stats are simply numbers. And even in those, the P-47 scores spectacular results. It has one of the highest kill-to-death ratios of World War II. It has one of the lowest lose-to-sortie ratio of World War II. I mean, in every way, statistic or not, this plane was a fantastic fighter. And I actually think it was the one that won the air war over Europe for the American Air Force. Because, I mean, a lot of credit is given to the Mustang, but when the Mustang was there in big numbers enough to matter, the Luftwaffe was a shadow of what it was when the P-47 was fighting the most deadly war, battles that were fought over Europe. So, yeah, I think this was actually the fighter that won the war for America, not the Mustang. The Mustang was a splendid fighter as well, but I think it gets a little bit of the rep that the P-47 deserves. And I also wanted to make a video just to put a light on that, because I really think that this plane doesn't get anywhere close to the fame it deserves. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. There will be more like this. Not necessarily about planes, might be about any other random stuff that I might think about and want to make a video of. I hope you have learned something, I hope you had fun listening to this, and as always, thank you very much for watching and see you later! Thank you.